Have you ever thought about the fact that music has the capability of evoking a place? For instance, there is a kind of music that is unmistakably proper to the cocktail lounge, with its quality of relaxed purposelessness and slight self-indulgence that characterizes the activity of a cocktail bar. Other places, the dance hall, its music is so integral to its activity. The military march, in 18th century music, the parlor, the theater, for instance, the tunes of musical comedy have a characteristic turn of phrase that exactly suits the that exactly suits the stereotype situations of that theater. The rock concert, the church. There is music that belongs only in church. And hearing a brief quotation of it immediately recalls the environs of the church, recalls a sacred place. That music is principally Gregorian chant, which is the preeminently sacred music. What makes this and other kinds of music sacred? Is it even possible for music to be sacred? Aren't musical notes neutral, neither sacred nor secular? On the feast of St. Cecilia, November 22, 1903, Pope St. Pius X issued his motu proprio, Trale Sollecitudine, the charter for the revival of Gregorian chant in the 20th century. In it, he defined three qualities of sacred music. Quote, sacred music should possess in the highest degrees the qualities proper to the liturgy, in particular sanctity and goodness of form, which will spontaneously produce the final quality of universality. I will say more about goodness of form and university later, but the most universality later, but the most difficult of these qualities is holiness or sacredness, and that is the principal focus of my discussion today. The definition of sacred and its distinction from and relation to holy is essential. Sacred concerns divine worship. An act of worship is the highest thing a human being can do, and so it is a basic human need to have things that support it. Worship addresses the transcendent and needs the support of things that are distinct from the everyday, the secular, the mundane, both in kind and degree. Sacred has the basic meaning of being set aside. Latin has two words, sanctus and sacer. Etymologically, these terms both derive from an action of setting aside. Usage, however, establishes the distinction between something intrinsic, sanctus, and something purposely set aside, sacer or sacratus. Germanic terms make a more fundamental distinction. Heilig, holy, refers to the intrinsic aspect of the other, a quality of being whole, complete, perfect, and even health-giving, saving. While geistlich refers to the subject, the spirituality of the subject perceiving the wholeness. English has a particular marriage of romance and Germanic elements, in which, for instance, the romance represents the indoor or domestic aspect, such as pork as a food, while Germanic represents the outdoor or cosmic aspect, such as swine as the living animal. In this fashion, the Germanic holy, the English word holy, with Germanic root, represents a cosmic aspect, and the romance, sacred, its orderly access. While holy pertains to something intrinsic, sacred is a participle denoting an action done to an object, setting it aside. We call a saint holy, but a bishop sacred. The Mass, holy, but the liturgy, sacred. Sacred, then, includes a substantial component of reception. Things not naturally taken to be sacred can become so by usage. Thus, I would define sacred as things set aside for the service of the holy. But sacred things have two complementary aspects. First, an intrinsic suitability or aptness to the sacred purpose. And second, a process of reception, of being taken for sacred. Take as an example the chasuble, the principal vestment of the priest at Mass. It was a conventional outer garment of a Roman citizen. Presumably, priests wore it at the celebration of Mass. But as it went out of fashion, it remained in use at Mass until, by the time it was no longer used at all as a secular garment, it had become received as a sacred garment. It had become a sacred item by a process of reception, much like the ordinary 17th century black frock coats later became for Hasidic Jews a mark of their being set apart. But sacred things also should have an intrinsic suitability to their purpose. Not everything is equally suitable to serving the holy. Thus, the chasuble is particularly suitable to its purpose because it covers the whole man. Its tent-like structure expresses the consecration of the priest being transformed from an ordinary person to an altar Christus. There are, however, other characteristics of the reception of sacred things. Their reception makes them ample, excellent, and distinct, with the result that their sacrality becomes unambiguous. Thus, the chasuble may have become a more encompassing garment in its reception, symbolizing better the secular Roman garment, the encompassing character of the priestly office. Likewise, now, the garment is made of silk, a precious fabric, the excellence of which makes it suitable for use in the worship of God, who is the source of all goodness. And it is given additional decoration, emphasizing that excellence. But now, as well, the sacredness of the garment is made complete by using sacred symbols on it, crosses, chiro, even images. It is now quite distinct from the original Roman garment. It is now unambiguously sacred. Reception based upon convention can be the result of a process of gradual acceptance as sacred, or it can be a convention that is received as always having been sacred. Incense is an example. Already in the Old Testament, it is an element of temple worship. Some speculate that it had the purpose of covering the smell of animal sacrifices. That could well have been a secondary function, but that does not explain why it was burned before the Holy of Holies, or why the psalm says, "Let my prayer ascend as incense before thy sight." Likewise, some have said that it came from the Byzantine court ceremonial and therefore had a secular origin. But the Byzantine emperor held a sacred office, and this was an essentially sacred usage. Incense is thus apt for sacred usage because it is a symbol of prayer ascending. It is made of a rare resin, a precious item only grown in a few places in the world, and it has a distinctive fragrance unlike any other, so that because it is used exclusively in sacred contexts, its distinctiveness expresses the unique character of sacred worship. As a precious item which is consumed, burned in its use, it has a sacrificial aspect. It is immolated. If you're accustomed to attending worship where incense is regularly used, or even if occasionally you attend benediction where it is almost always used, you will recognize the phenomenon. Catch only a whiff of incense, and you will say, "Oh, I am in church." This is an intuitive response, not the result of reasoned conclusion. an instinctive recognition of something immediately evident. The same can be said of many things which are sacred, the colors of vestments, the presence and absence of flowers, and especially the music. Music is capable, especially, of expressing the sacredness of the liturgy, but it is also capable of contradicting it through the use of styles too closely associated with secular contexts. And this is one of my main points today. There is a great variety of kinds of music, some more appropriate for divine worship than others. And the use of music in the liturgy needs to take into account the intrinsic characteristics of the music itself in judging what is more suitable for the liturgy, not just its texts, but the music itself. So how is music apt for sacred purposes? The Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy from the Second Vatican Council set a principal criterion. Quote, "The musical tradition of the Universal Church is a treasure of inestimable value, greater even than any other art. The main reason for this preeminence is that, as sacred song united to the words, it forms a necessary or integral part of the solemn liturgy. Sacred music will be the more holy, the more closely it is joined to the liturgical rite, whether by adding delight to prayer, fostering oneness of spirit, or investing the rites with greater solemnity." Pope John Paul II expressed it more explicitly in a letter commemorating the 100th anniversary of Pius X's motu proprio. Quote, "Liturgical music must meet the specific prerequisites of the liturgy, full adherence to the text it presents, synchronization with the time and moment in the liturgy for which it is intended, appropriately reflecting the gestures proposed by the rites. The various moments in the liturgy require a musical expression of their own. From time to time, this must fittingly bring out the nature proper to a specific rite, now proclaiming God's marvels, now expressing praise, supplication, or even sorrow for the experience of human suffering, which, however, faith opens to the prospect of Christian hope." The principal sacred music of the Roman Rite is Gregorian chant. The Second Vatican Council accorded it principal place. Pius X even held Gregorian chant up as the paradigm against which other sacred music could be judged. Why should Gregorian chant be the principal music? Why should Gregorian chant be the paradigm of sacred music? It is sometimes said by well-meaning commentators that Gregorian chant is the ideal setting of its text. Nothing could be further from the truth, for each Gregorian chant varies enormously from the others according to the liturgical action it accompanies. Each chant articulates the structure of its text and characterizes its particular action, distinguishing it from the others at the same time. This is an element of its sacrality, that the music bears an intrinsic relationship to the liturgical action. For example, the lessons of the liturgy of the word in the Mass, the Old Testament epistle and gospel. If we read aloud, these would sound much the same, and on Sunday morning they very often do. But when sung to proper chant melodies, each is strikingly distinguished from the other. For the Old Testament, usually a prophecy with a harsh message, the first half of the sentence goes down a half step. In a live church, it rings over and creates a slight dissonance, a harshness. The end of the sentence goes down a whole fifth, like the sound of a trumpet. So a text, "Rend your hearts, not your garments." For an epistle, a more rhetorical text, each sentence is set to a melody which underlines its persuasive quality. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church. The gospel, being a most direct and simple text, receives only a simple ending formula. Tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man has risen from the dead. Making an ascent at the end, leaving the listener elevated. A similar difference between prayers exists at three levels: collects, preface, and Lord's Prayer. The choir parts of the Mass, the propers, introit, gradual, offertory, alleluia, communion, are all based on psalm texts. Psalms are distinguished by a poetic quality that does not depend upon rhyme or meter, but rather repetition. Each psalm verse comprises two complementary statements. The just shall flourish like a palm tree, like a cedar of Lebanon, he shall be multiplied. The proper chants of the Mass are based upon such psalm verses, but their shape and function are suited to specifically liturgical purposes. Listen to the introit based upon that text, the just shall flourish like a palm tree. Justus ut palma florebit, sicut cedrus Libani multiplicabitur. Immediately one senses that something important is about to happen, something solemn. This chant accompanies the entrance of the procession into the church at the beginning of Mass, a purposeful motion to the focal point of the church, the altar, marking the altar as a sacred place by incensing it. The chant expresses a kind of purposeful but solemn motion. A similar chant would accompany the communion procession. Yet a different kind of chant is the gradual. This chant accompanies another action, but in a different way. It comes after the first lesson as a complement to that lesson. You may know it as the responsorial psalm, but in its Gregorian form, it is a melismatic chant. That is, some syllables, sometimes even seemingly not important syllables, receive melismas, a number of notes. Notice how beautiful this chant is. The same text. Justus ut palma florebit, sicut cedrus Libani. There are points in such melismatic chants when the melody seems to depart momentarily from the text. Clearly, its purpose is not just to set the text, rather it is also there for the beauty of the melody. I have observed our congregation, when a chant is sung really beautifully, we sometimes do that, there is an absolute still in the church. The entire congregation is focused upon listening to the chant. My conclusion is that the hearing of a melismatic chant like this elicits recollection, a stillness that is at the same time very active. This is quite different from the responsorial psalm that is usually sung in the parish. I have often asked, what is the purpose of the responsorial psalm? And get a response, to give the people something to do. A more specific purpose is expressed officially, it's true, in stating the purpose of having the people welcome the Lord in the Word. But I would propose that the matter of recollection, receptivity, are more fundamental to the liturgy of the Word than simply external activity. Pope John Paul II expressed this in his address to the bishops of the Pacific Northwest. Quote, active participation certainly means that in gesture, word, song, and service, all the members of the community take part in an act of worship, which is anything but inert or passive. Yet active participation does not preclude the passivity of silence, stillness, and listening. Indeed, it demands it. Worshippers are not passive, for instance, when listening to the readings or the homily, or following the prayers of the celebrant and the chants and music of the liturgy. These are experiences of silence and stillness, but they are in their own way profoundly active. In a culture which neither favors nor fosters meditative quiet, the art of interior listening is learned only with difficulty. Here we see how the liturgy, though it must always be properly enculturated, must also be countercultural. Thus, the people's proper participation in the liturgy of the word is to heed the lessons being read or sung, which may best be aided by these melismatic chants being sung by choir or cantor. There is thus an intimate link between liturgical action and the musical styles of the various Gregorian chant. There are also characteristics of chant in general that make it particularly suited to the sacred action. Chant is like incense in that it has always been received as sacred. The early church fathers jealously guarded the sacrality of liturgical music, strenuously excluding instruments which were used in pagan worship. This exclusion of instruments remains even today in the Orthodox Church, in the Sistine Chapel, and in the idea of a cappella singing cultivated by many church choirs, and even for the priest's chants in the prohibition still in effect of the use of any accompaniment of the priest's singing. Thus, Gregorian chant is essentially vocal, which means that it can bind directly with the texts of the liturgy to produce a beautiful way of delivering these texts in accord with the liturgical action they accompany. The human voice is best suited to expressing intimately the sacred sentiments of these texts. That the chants are so closely bound to their text makes their sacrality unambiguous. Chants are monophonic. That is, everyone sings exactly the same melody in unison. It is often commented that this represents a union of voices. In his Purgatorio, Dante seems to prefer unison singing to polyphony, commenting that singing in common represents a concord of hearts. Gregorian chants were formed and passed down without the aid of notation, from memory. An enormous repertory of music was learned, generally when singers were children, who then had it for a lifetime. There is something important to sacred music in singing from memory. When we sing from memory, we sing from what is within us. The experience of singing from memory is crucial for prayer because we are singing by heart. It's no accident that to sing from memory is called to sing by heart. Some conventions of the performance of chant acquired a sacred sense. This is the case with antiphonal singing. Choirs were divided in half and seated with each half facing the other. Their singing of the psalms was divided between the two halves, and since this was mainly for the chanting of the 150 psalms in the course of the week, it came to be received as a sacred practice. It was then given an additional sacred meaning by comparing it to the seraphim, who cried out each to the other before the face of God, "Holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts." Gregorian chants do not use regular meters as most other music. Regular meters and a strong beat expresses a keen sense of the passage of time. The suspension of these regular temporal phenomena expresses the opposite. By avoiding the sense of passage of time, it can evoke an intimation, at least, of eternity. Rebecca Stewart, a musicologist who has studied sacred musics across the world, says that sacred music is always seeking. And when she says it, she always goes like that. Sacred music is always seeking. I think that such seeking is for eternity, and it is helped by the metric irregularity of the chant. Likewise, some Gregorian chants are quite melismatic. If you take psalmody to be the normal pace of delivery of a text, Dixit Dominus Domino Meo, Sedea Dextris Meis, then the pace of the text of melismatic chants is slow indeed. You would never say, "This is the day the Lord has made," but that's the pace that you would sing the gradual to. This, like metric irregularity, suggests the slowing down of the passage of time, intimating eternity. The prose text of the chants, eschewing any metric regularity, contribute to this effect as well. The very setting of its text to melody affects a kind of setting aside, as Josef Jungmann put it. Setting to melody affects the setting aside of a text, serving it on a golden platter, as Jungmann says, conveying its being dedicated to a high purpose. Thus, chant is a kind of musical incense, conveying in an instant a sacred purpose. Sacred polyphony, vocal music sung in many parts, however, is also given a particular status by the tradition and emphasized by the Second Vatican Council. Part of its sacred status derives from its link to chant, for often its melodies are borrowed from chant. I will show you several examples which will illustrate how polyphonic styles played a role in the reception of sacrality by growing out of the use of chant melodies, and how in some cases they incorporated secular influences as well. The interpolation of polyphonic music in the liturgy took place in many ways. One way was to replace one element in an antiphonal arrangement. Originally, the Sanctus melody could be sung by two halves of the choir answering back and forth, singing the chant melody. One side, Sanctus, the other side, Sanctus, Sanctus. You could replace one of those chant sides with a side singing polyphony, elaborating upon the chant melody itself, and this is an example of it in Heinrich Isaac's setting of a Gregorian Sanctus melody. Now let's see if this works. There's another element that's illustrated by that, and that is,
Stop.
That sacred music can be ample. The elaboration of those simple sanctus melodies is in fact 4 or 5 times as long as it would have taken to sing the chant. And yet, that makes it all the more beautiful and as equally as sacred, partly because the polyphonic setting includes the melody of the chant in the voices in turn. Another way of in which the chant can, in fact, embody a sacredness in a polyphonic setting is to use a cantus firmus. That is to say, lengthening the notes of the chant melody so that it stands out among the voices of the polyphony. An extreme way of doing this was in the Gothic polyphony of Perrotin for Notre Dame Cathedral. Each note of the given chant melody was extended to the point that a whole phrase of additional music could be placed over it. Hear the beginning of Perrotin's Viderunt Omnes. The beginning of the chant melody sounds like this. Fider. That's all we need to produce this much music. That's the chant melody, the first note. Second note. That is what you call Gothic music. It has every bit as much elaboration and detail and extensiveness as the height of a Gothic cathedral. In the 15th century, the cantus firmus became a standard way of setting the ordinary of the Mass. Those sung parts which remain the same from day to day, Kyrie, Gloria, Credo, Sanctus, and Agnus Dei. By using the same chant melody for all 5 movements, a greater unity among these diverse texts was created, though it was not a unity that derived from the melodies that belonged to the individual texts. It was not how a Kyrie melody being used as a polyphonic setting of Kyrie, but rather the same melody for all movements, often a marionettophon, for example, giving the whole Mass an additional dimension of a Marian overtone. But it was not always even a Gregorian melody that formed the cantus firmus. The cantus firmus technique itself formed a kind of basis for its reception as a sacred device. A notable example of this is the Lomarmé melody, a secular tune. The phenomenon of the use of a secular cantus firmus is often cited as a precedent for the use of popular styles in the liturgy today. But there is a difference. In a cantus firmus Mass, the secular tune becomes elongated as a cantus firmus and literally surrounded by other voices singing in a sacred style. Thus, by a polyphonic style, the secular melody is baptized, so to speak, and made to serve a sacred purpose, without, however, losing all of its secular meanings. Rather, those meanings themselves are taken into the sacred sphere. Here is the tune, Lo Marmé, the armed man, one must fear him. Loma, 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 lo marmé, lo marmé, lo marmé, on doit en douter. So that's the tune. Here is Josquin's setting of the credo, which includes Lo Marmé. It has a long two-voice introduction, after which the tenor begins to sing the Lo Marmé melody in long notes. Now a long introduction in two voices. There's a tenor starting Lo Marmé. Next note of the Lo Marmé is there. Cantus firmus constructs, the very cantus firmus style was already a sacred style, so there's scarcely any ambiguity created by the incorporation of the secular melody. There is another wrinkle to the story, however. The Lo Marmé tune was not just any old popular song. It had acquired a number of sacred symbolic meanings. First, the emperor, dressed in armor, carrying a sword, sang the gospel at the midnight mass of Christmas, a sacred role. A mass of the armed man was celebrated in which a man dressed in armor stood by the altar for the whole mass, perhaps symbolizing their concept that there were sacred purposes in the nightly offices they held. This cantus firmus, then, was a musical equivalent of the sacralized armed man visually standing before them at Mass. A cantus firmus construction represents a hierarchical conception of composition in which one voice has priority over the others. Such priorities go back to the music of the 12th and 13th centuries, a time when hierarchical conception of the universe and society was prevalent. By the Renaissance, however, such hierarchies had fallen to the background, and works of art often represented equalities rather than subordination. So a shift in the construction of sacred pieces took place. While keeping a Gregorian melody, the voices are now treated more equally, each voice carrying the melody in turn. Josquin's Missa Pungit Lingua uses the still familiar chant of Thomas Aquinas' hymn, Pungit Lingua Gloriosi. Each voice carries the tune in overlapping statements, first the first phrase and then the second in a polyphonic web of increasing complexity and interest. Pungit Lingua. Da. Next voice takes it over. Another voice takes it over. No no cantus firmus anymore, but the chant is still equally present. The imitative style of the Panja lingua, in which the voices are said to imitate each other, each voice takes the same subject in turn. This became the canonical sacred style of the 16th century, with Josquin's role in this ars perfecta, the perfect art, being lionized by the theorist Glorionis. In the hands of a late Renaissance master, Palestrina, it received a classic formation. Listen to the melody of Sicut Servos of Palestrina, first as sung by each voice, then in polyphonic complex. So this way, Sicut Servus desiderat ad fontes aquarum. And then the next one, Sicut Servus, etc. So that each voice takes it in turn. Here is how that works. Another voice, same melody. Another voice in the bottom. Why should such an imitative style be so suited to sacred music? After all, it was used for secular texts as well. What of the sacred does it convey? Renaissance theorists understood this question well, for they saw its palpable harmonies as reflecting the harmony of the created universe, a cosmic harmony and the corresponding internal harmonies of the soul. And it was not just the harmonies, but the harmonious interaction of the same melody with itself that conveyed an image of purposeful order in motion, an image of an orderly creation which ultimately pointed to a creator who sets it in motion. There was a musical revolution at the turn of the 17th century in which a newly expressive musical style was placed alongside the old imitative style. When composing a mass, Monteverdi made a conscious juxtaposition of a style, the effective character of the text, juxtaposed with a thoroughgoing imitative style. In his Messa da Cappella, he sets that portion of the Gloria that recalls the peaceful repose of the night of the Nativity of Christ, and on earth peace to men of goodwill, to a direct harmonic style that brings out its accent of the text, while setting the subsequent acclamations, Laudamus te, Benedicimus te, we praise thee, we bless thee, to a thoroughgoing and systematic imitation. Homophonic style, peaceful, effective. Now imitation. That harmonic style, then, sometimes called the familiar style, in which the parts all sing the text simultaneously and accompany a melody in the top voice, comes to the fore in the hymnody of the Reformation. One such famous hymn, the Passion Chorale, which we know with the text, O Sacred Head, actually had a secular origin. Hans Leo Hassler set this text at the turn of the 17th century. My emotion is all asunder. A sweet young lady has done this. I am totally distracted and heartsick. I have no rest day and night, and I'm always making my complaint. I sigh and weep and mourn. That's Hostler's text, and it goes like this. Mein Gemüt ist mir verwirret, das macht ein Jungfrau zart. Bin ganz und gar verirret, mein Herz, das kränkt sich hart. Hab Tag und Nacht kein Ruh, für Allzeit große Klag. Tu stets zu säufen weinen, in Trauren schier verzag. The distracted character of the speaker is represented by shifts of meter and tempo written out in the music. And his sadness is reflected by the Phrygian mode, which has that characteristic descent of the half step at the cadence. In Trauren schier verzag, die da die is the scale. This is the tune ultimately used by Bach in his St. Matthew Passion, where the tune is straightened out metrically and slowed down somewhat, but still retains the sense of intense emotion. Toward the end of the Passion, the same tune is reharmonized, including some striking harmonic shifts, chromaticisms, and express a subdued but intense emotion of the conclusion of the Passion. These have all been examples of sacred music whose sacredness has aspects of reception and also of aptness of the music itself to sacred purposes. This prompts some reflections on how music has meaning. Some of the meaning of music derives from the beauty of the elements of the music, the harmony, the interaction of voices, but these meanings are always in the context of already heard music. Like a language, we understand words in a language because we've heard them before. Already heard music also brings with it associations, such as associations with place. I recall attending a mass at which the priest intoned the Gloria, and a combo, flute, piano, string bass, and drums, struck up a piece that so resembled the music of the cocktail lounge that the first thing that came to mind was, "Where's my martini?" When such place-specific musical styles are transferred into church, the sacred character of the place is negated and an incongruity is introduced into the holy place. A song, already the title suggests an incongruity, that replicates the style of musical comedy introduces that kind of incongruity in the sacred place and works its damage in several ways. The style in musical comedy deals with stereotyped situations and emotions in reaction to them for the sake of pure entertainment. That is, it flatters its audience by giving it something the content of which they can instantly master and respond to. Sacred music, on the other hand, should draw the congregation out. It should lift them to the level higher than they were, than they are right now. The songs one hears in church today may merely reinforce what is already there. It is not clear that in the present time the incorporation of popular style of music has in fact observed the principle of having been assumed into a sacred style. Pop styles, even rock styles, have been incorporated lock, stock, and barrel without a sufficient degree of transformation. If there has been any transformation, it is insufficient to establish unambiguously the priority of the sacred. Rather, the secular has dominated the sacred realm. There is, however, a Christian approach to the sacred that does not entirely exclude the secular. It is not just to stand in awe of a mysterium tremendum, though that is a beginning point. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, not its end. but to enter into the sacred, to have commerce with it, and by that to be elevated and transformed by it. The sacred is in this process the means. The end is the encounter with the holy, the commerce with the holy, the meeting of the Lord in the most intimate way. It is surely the case that this encounter is taken back to the everyday. It should transform it. In my estimation, the medieval notion of the sacred is not one of an opposition of sacred with profane, though that opposition plays a certain role sometimes. Rather, it is a matter of degrees of sacred. A medieval cathedral has its most centrally sacred point at its altar, surrounded by decreasingly sacred spaces and boundaries, including the boundaries between the building and the city. But the city itself has boundaries, and it is the dwelling place of the people of God. It has its own kind of sacredness. This sacredness is commemorated in the Sarum Palm Sunday procession, which enters into the city gates before entering into the church, as if entering the holy city of Jerusalem. Let me conclude by saying just something about Pius X's other characteristics of the sacred liturgy. After the sacred, he mentions what is sometimes translated as beautiful, or more literally, goodness of form. But the most accurate translation is goodness of forms, plural, bontà delle forme, or bonitas formarem. I hope you can at least glimpse that forms in the plural must mean the variety of musical ways of setting lessons, prayers, and chants, which I showed. I will address my point specifically in my lecture tomorrow. Thus, the Gregorian music constitutes a showing forth of the sacred liturgy itself, its splendor formae, a term scholastics used to define beauty. Why should the liturgy be beautiful? Beauty is a transcendental, something characteristic of all things in different ways, but most characteristic of God. Thus, beauty leads to God by analogy. Beautiful things can lift the soul up. Better, beautiful things remind us by depicting particular kinds of order of the creator of order. Their very abstractness brings our minds to encounter principles of beauty itself, so that we see as a magnificent design the work of creation. Its being embodied in the concrete makes the experience a palpable one, brings it home. Pius XII's other characteristic universal has to do with reception, but it is a requisite in the sense that dealing with universal truths, it has to represent them in a way that all can in one way have access to them. This could be a formula for triviality, and one has observed this, if it lead to reduction to a common denominator. The alternative is to have stable things received by tradition. If something is excellent and received from childhood, its excellence will sustain its repetition, and its reception from childhood will ensure familiarity. You ask an Episcopalian, why do you love those hymns so much? And they will say, it's because it's what we grew up with. Gregorian chant should always be there. You should grow up with it. You should be familiar with it. Thus, music should contribute to making the liturgy more sacred and more beautiful, and in such a way that it is accessible to the whole church. A tall order, you might say. Indeed, it pertains to the salvation of souls, to the highest things we can do on this earth. A beautiful and sacred liturgy will draw souls to it, and through it, to a love of God. A tall order, but all the more reason to do it well.